Philippine economic managers lauding the Senate for the swift passage of the Maharlika Investment Fund Bill. Finance Chief Benjamin Diokno says the Senate's version reflects the Marcos administration's objective of creating a profitable and secure investment fund. Budget Chief Amena Pangandaman, meanwhile, calls it a great stride towards long-term progress that will boost efforts for economic growth. Members of the economic team were present during the extended Senate session to support the bill's immediate passage. They insisted there are enough safeguards to make sure the fund is not abused. The Philippine Congress begins reconciling the Senate and House versions of the Maharlika Investment Fund Bill. The bicameral meeting comes just hours after the bill hurdled the Senate. Top congressional leaders, Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri and Speaker Martin Romualdez, are present in the meeting. Major changes to the Senate's version of the bill include explicitly prohibiting state pension funds like the government service insurance system and the social welfare system from investing in the Maharlika Fund.
The form that we are passing now, I think, satisfies our thirst for transparency and accountability on this measure. I think the number of amendments that we placed here will assure the Filipino people that this fund will be used properly, efficiently, and effectively.
19 senators voted in favor of the measure. Senator Nancy Binay abstained from voting, while Senator Risa Ontiveros voted against the bill. Senators Coco Pimentel, Chiz Escudero, and Amy Marcos were not present during the vote.
I fully agree with the sponsor's belief that a new kind of public financing is needed. We need to learn how to leverage the capital resources that we have so that we could do more with the little that we have. My belief is that the idea of a sovereign wealth fund will make sense sometime in the medium term, perhaps when we have the surpluses. It's ahead of its time, so to speak.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr., meanwhile, allays concerns on funding sources of the proposed sovereign wealth fund. He made an assurance pension funds won't be used as seed money for the MIF during an event of the GSIS. Let's get more details from ABS-CBN's Pia Gutierrez. Pia?
Yes, money from the state pension funds, SSF and GSIS, will not be used to seed the Maharlika Investment Fund. That statement coming from President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. after the Senate adopted an amendment in its version of the Maharlika Fund Bill that prohibits state pension and insurance funds like the GSIS and SSF from investing in the fund. However, the president clarifies it is still up to these institutions to invest in the proposed sovereign wealth fund should they decide that it is still a good investment. Marcos Jr., during the 86th anniversary of the GSIS Wednesday morning, says it is the role of these institutions to grow their funds through investments to ensure its stability. Let's listen to what President Marcos Jr. said.
Secretary Anton
Latameo. We will not use it as a seed fund. However, if a pension fund, which is what pension funds do, is they invest. If the pension fund decides that the Maharlika fund is a good investment, it's up to them if they want to invest in it. So, like any, not only a pension fund, but corporations, mga fund, yan lang ang ginagawa nila, pinapalaki ng pera nila para mayroon silang may bigay. Like hey, GSIS, this is precisely what they've been doing. They're making sure they're very solid, that they're very stable, so that all the payments that they need to give out. So we have to differentiate those two things. But no, we will not use it as a seed fund.
Meanwhile, GSIS President and General Manager Rick Veloso said that they will merely abide with the decision of the lawmakers regarding the Maharlika Investment Fund. Meanwhile, Veloso also says President Marcos Jr. has directed the GSIS to act as fund manager of the pensions of military and other uniformed personnel as part of the proposed reforms in their pension system. This was discussed in the ongoing comprehensive multi-sectoral discussions on the proposed pension reform. The president, in his speech during the GSIS anniversary, noted noted the need to establish the most appropriate and strategic mechanism to get the reformed pension system for military and uniformed personnel functioning, or at the very least to lay the foundation for the system that will function in the long run. Marcos Jr. also thanked the GSIS for their involvement and participation in the MUP pension reform, noting that the agency's experience and acquired skills have been an important part of the ongoing process. The president earlier warned that the pension fund for military and other uniformed personnel will be depleted in 5 to 6 years if the government does not find ways to ensure that the pension system is self-sustaining. Denise.
Thanks for that report, Pia. For a former National Economic and Development Authority secretary, the passage of the Maharlika Investment Fund Bill may just be a political move. Winnie Monsod points out, senators have failed to specify how the Maharlika Fund would be economically helpful. She also warns of a financial disaster if investments from the fund would only go to unnecessary and unproductive government projects.
This is a strictly political move, not an economic move on the part of the senators. We are hoping that any fund that we get, a sovereign wealth fund, a truly sovereign wealth fund, will be economically helpful, because that's what they're touting. It's for economic development, etc. But they do not show the relationship. Mm-hmm. Because you have the Philippine Development Plan, you have all the projects, mm-hmm. all the investment projects that are needed for that Philippine Development Plan. And they supposedly have funding or will have funding from abroad or whatever. Mm-hmm. So what are the other projects that they're talking about?
Vigilance is key to ensuring the success of the Maharlika Fund, according to some business groups. FedEx Academy Chairman Attorney Francis Lim believes the fund would only yield its expected results if it would be headed by the right people.
We would have to accept what our policymakers, particularly Congress, is doing now. But the challenge that I see here is that we should put in place a very good set of board and investment committee members in the MIF, no? Because it is them that make the final decision as to where to invest the limited resources that this Maharlika Fund has. Or will have. No matter how strong the law is, if you have the wrong people running the fund, or any corporation for that matter, or any public corporation, be it a GIF or ordinary government corporations, I think things will go wrong.
The Semiconductor and Electronics Industries and the Philippine Foundation also weighing in. It says it remains to be seen whether the proposed sovereign wealth fund can make do with limited resources.
The Maharlika funds work for countries that developed countries that have funds, to generate investments and economic growth. I'm not sure that the coffers of the Philippines, the treasury that we have, the trade balance or imbalance, as it were, would be a workable plan. You know, I'd be concerned if we dig into the investment funds of government and the public sector.
For an online petitioner against the Maharlika Fund, the history of corruption in the Philippines is among the major reasons why the measure is controversial. Michael San Juan says while putting billions of pesos of government money into the fund is a risky move in itself, good governance is the bigger issue. He also fears the Maharlika Investment Fund would only benefit few corporations and individuals.
Ang kaibahan po kasi ng Norway sa Pilipinas, ang Norway ay kilala sa good governance, sa Corruption Perceptions Index. Kasama sila sa least corrupt or yung isa sa mga bansang hindi corrupt. Ang Pilipinas, alam nyo na siguro kung nasaan. kasama tayo doon sa may tuturing na medyo may matinding korupsyon. Kaya paano ngayon natin sasabihin na magagaya natin sa Norway? Kahit sabihin lang may mga board of directors, independent auditors, etc. Mm-hmm. Walang tiwala taong bayan.
San Juan launched the online petition against the MIF late last year when the bill was being debated at the lower house. It has since gathered over 84,000 signatures. The public outcry against the proposed Maharlika Fund comes as the debt of the Philippine government increases. It reached 13.91 trillion pesos at the end of April. That's over 54 billion pesos, or 0.4% higher compared to the previous month. The increase was attributed to the net issuance of external debt and the local currency's depreciation against the U.S. dollar. The government earlier said its debt-to-GDP ratio improved to 60.9% in 2022. The Philippine Central Bank sees inflation further cooling in May. The BSP says inflation for the month likely settled within the range of 5.8 to 6.6%. April's inflation print stood at 6.6%. The BSP says upward price pressures for May include higher prices of key food items and an increase in power rates, but those could be offset by rollbacks in pump prices. The May inflation report will be released Tuesday next week. The lawyer of Philippine lawmaker Arnolfo Teves Jr. insists the embattled congressman is under no obligation to return home. This as Teves faces potential stiffer penalties over his absence in Congress. Jeff Caparaz joins us on the line for more on that. Jeff?
Yes, Denise, good afternoon. The Camp of Negros Oriental 3rd District Representative Arnolfo Teves Jr. says they will go to the Supreme Court and Office of the Ombudsman if expulsion will be the penalty of the House of Representatives to Teves. According to Attorney Ferdinand Topacio, these are their options if ever they see violations to the constitutional rights of the congressman, such as right to equal protection and right to be heard. The House Committee on Ethics and Privileges has recommended to the House of Representatives that it impose stiffer penalties on Teves Jr., as the lawmaker continues to stay overseas with an expired travel authority. The panel reconvened behind closed door on Monday morning to discuss Teves Jr.'s case with representatives from the Commission on Elections, Bureau of Immigration, Department of Foreign Affairs, Civil Service Commission, and Philippine National Police in attendance. Topacio had questioned why this was conducted on closed doors. Teves Jr. may appeal any decision on the next session, which will be in July. Meanwhile, as Teves' lawyer, Topacio believed that the recantation of the gunman might weaken the case. Denise?
Thanks, Jeff. In Negros Oriental, Governor Guido Reyes has passed away. Reyes's death comes more than 2 months since his predecessor, Ruel Degamo, was assassinated at his home in Pamplona town. The provincial administrator says Reyes was battling a lingering disease, but did not provide details. Vice Governor Manuel Sagarabia is expected to assume the governorship soon.